So I learned how to play baseball first, and I love baseball.
The electrifying point guard of your Memphis State Tigers, a member of the 1985 Final Four team and the current head coach of Lane College men's basketball, the little general himself, Coach Andre Turner, joins us today. So Andre Turner, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you so much. I'm so thrilled to be here.
We are so excited to have you here. I can tell Michael is already giggly over there. You're one of his heroes, and I've had to like calm him down a little bit, but that's all good. We want to show you love. We really do. So let's talk about a little bit about what you are doing now, because that's pretty exciting.
Well, thank you. It's absolutely exciting to me. I want to say new head basketball coach at Lane College, because this is my second year, getting ready to go into my third year. So I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing right now in my life. I'm affecting the lives of young men and then trying to teach them some life skills at the same time. I'm enjoying where I am. It's up the road, about an hour from home. So it's not a big stretch, but basketball has been my life. I've been affected by it tremendously. I've been able to do so many things with it. So I'm doing exactly what I'm supposed to be doing right now in my life.
It's funny that you are doing that, Dre, because I think you are a natural leader. You know, they used to call you the little general anyway. So you were born to lead, man. So you are exactly, I think you are exactly where you're supposed to be, man. So I'm glad it worked out. I'm glad it's working out so far.
I appreciate it. Someone had enough gump to say, hey, Coach Turner, you think you might want to be a basketball coach on the college level? I said, yeah, why not? It's time.
So I do have a question. Where did the nickname Little General actually come from? Was it at Mitchell High School?
Well, it stemmed from Mitchell High School and Dana, you know, my man Dana Kirk, who was my guy at Memphis State at the time. But anyway, it was he just said, when he came to watch me and was scouting, he just was watching how I was directing the guys and how I wasn't afraid to go and talk to any of the guys on the team and tell them, you know, about doing certain things. That my big guys wouldn't rebound and I wouldn't be afraid to get in, you know, their faces. And it was like, man, he was a general and he's small, you know, but he's a general. So it's like, it is, you know, dabbing a little general. So, you know, when Jack Eaton heard it, it took off.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, a mutual friend of ours, actually, he was your Bluff City teammate, a guy by the name of Retushy Spears, man. We were talking about you the other day, and he was like, oh, yeah, Dre, don't let that size fool you, and don't let that smile fool you. Whatever he lacks in size, he makes up for it on the court, and he will get in your face, and he's not afraid. He's not afraid at all. He don't care how big you are. He don't care who you are.
Yeah, I just loved everybody. That's all. I just loved everybody. That's all.
Yeah, you love pretty hard, man. And that's good, man. And that's a coach's dream. A coach's dream is to sit there and let their point guard be the coach on the floor. Coaches don't want to run back and yell back and forth to each other. So having a point guard like that is a coach's dream, man. So,
yeah,
I know that's why they had to get you.
So when did you actually did you always want to play basketball, or when you were really little, did you want to be something else?
Well, I had older brothers. I had a brother that was 5 years and 7 years older than I was. And I trailed up behind, and my oldest played everything. He played baseball, football, basketball, and ran track. And absolutely. Yeah. And he was the valedictorian on top of it at Mitchell High School. And so I had big shoes, you know, to fill
early.
And when I tell you he did everything. I mean, and look up, in his math and mechanical drawing trophies were bigger than his athletic trophies. And I was like, man, you're talking about all this academics, you know, and then he's doing everything, you know, in athletics. But the love for the sports came very early. And I often tell the story, but a lot of times I like my cousin to tell the story. But I was a fourth grader, and my cousin was a sixth grader at the time. And he was playing for a church, Lindenwood Christian Church. And one of the guys on their team had to leave because the parents were leaving to go out of town. And he told his coach that he had a fourth grade little cousin that could play a little bit. And the coach was like, hey, we don't need little fourth graders on our team. And he was like, no, but coach, try him. And so he asked me to come. And I begged my mom to buy those Chuck Taylors. And and when I tell you, I begged, and she broke down and finally bought me the Chuck Taylor. So, you know, I was running fast and jumping higher than anybody with those new shoes. My cousin had scored 19 points twice during the season. He was the leading scorer of the team. And so that particular game that I played, I had 10 steals and 10 layups, and I scored 20. And he was happy and mad at the same time.
Yeah,
he had scored 19 twice, and then his little cousin come and scored 20. You know, and he tells the story all the time that he really got me my start playing, you know, in organized basketball. And so that team at Lindenwood Christian Church was my first time playing on an organized team.
Did you play other sports?
Oh, baseball, actually, you know, that's something you ask, because baseball was actually my first love.
Really?
My dad was a baseball guy. My dad probably came to see me, I'm gonna say, and it, you know, it's touching, you know, but sometimes it's a little it messes with your heart a little bit. But my dad watched me play one game of basketball. And he came to one of my high school games. Never watched me play in college. My dad ended up passing my junior year in college. That was the only game that I missed my entire college career. And that was against Kansas at Kansas. He was a baseball guy, man. He would wake me up at 6 and 7 in the morning on Saturday and say, hey, let's get it. We got to go to baseball practice. And so I learned how to play baseball first. And I love baseball.
So why didn't you go the baseball route?
I played it all the way up until my 12th grade year. I mean, that baseball was, and you don't toot your own horn, but I was decent. I made my little all tournament teams, all this and that teams in junior high and high school. Of course, you see, I say junior high, so I'm dating myself too.
Oh, I hate that's what I say too.
Not middle school. Yeah, but a good old junior high. But I loved baseball, and actually a good friend of mine, Tim Doolin, who was at Memphis at the time, playing baseball. He tried for 2 years straight, tried to encourage me to come out for baseball. And I just was so focused on basketball and school that I just didn't. But oftentimes I kind of regret that I didn't go out and pursue baseball a little further.
So why did your father not come to your basketball games? Was it because he was hurt that you chose basketball over baseball?
I don't really think so. I just think he just wasn't into basketball. Now my mom and my grandmom, they traveled. They had, you know, Andre's mom, Andre's grandmom on the back of their shirts.
I remember that.
They supported me. And my dad supported my dad. He's the reason that I have the work ethic that I have. Because I watched him, you know, every day, you know, 5:30 in the morning, get up, you know, get to work, and then come back at 7, you know, every day, you know, even on Sunday some days. And so every once in a while, he might have had a Sunday off. So my work ethic undoubtedly, you know, comes from my dad, because, you know, he got out there and got it and made sure that, you know, we had that roof over our head. We made sure we had food on the table. And, you know, I absolutely love that about him. And you know, dads in those times, they weren't the, you know, the lovey-dovey type where, you know, hey, come here, son, I love you on the hook, you know,
right.
But we knew they did, you know, we absolutely knew they did. And so, you know, as a dad, you know, you just kind of say, okay, I might've missed that a little bit. So I want to make sure that my kids don't miss out on getting that from me.
Right.
Hey, Dre, I know we talked on the phone the other day, but I just wanted to ask you this. Do you know how important you are to the city of Memphis? To the University of Memphis. Now, I know you say Memphis State, but do you really know the significance of the time that you were there? Because I'll tell you this, man, I'm dating myself. I don't want to make you feel old, but I remember when you guys were winning the Metro championship, right?
Absolutely.
And school stopped. School actually stopped. Teachers had TVs in the classroom, and we were watching the games. And I remember when you guys made it to the tournament, you guys were coming off the airplane from the private plane, and the fans were meeting you there. And I remember that. And so when we made the tournament, I was like, man, here it comes. And they were waiting for us at the
Absolutely.
Thing. So you were a part of our motivation. Do you know how important you were to the university?
You know, you asked that question, Mike. I guess because I love you know, so much where I'm from. I love the history, you know, of Memphis and its basketball. As you know, we were conversating the other day, all the guys that were before me, how much I respected and would, you know, to an extent, give those guys those flowers, the flowers when I would see them, and just tell them how much I admired them. You know, you get to talking that basketball talk, man. You know, you were cold, and I mean, how, you know, you could shoot it, yeah. Man. And so I love doing it. And so when my opportunity came to get on that basketball court and give everything that I have, I always did that. But you know, so far as me understanding and really realizing the significance or how important I was to, I just felt like, you know, everybody has, you know, their place and their part, right, in what they do. And I had mine. I had, you know, the opportunity that I had, and I played with a bunch of great guys. You know, I had great teams. Now, guys don't talk about, you know, me making assists or doing the things that I did, but I had a, you know, pretty good basketball team that I played with as well.
To say the least, yeah.
Yeah, to say the least. Yeah. I had first rounders, NBA first rounders, and guys that played in the league for a while, you know, on my team.
Yeah, so, yeah, I just wanted to let you know, man, that Memphis didn't have to recruit a lot of us because of you guys. We watched you guys on TV and we saw the impact and the love that you guys got from the city of Memphis and how you brought everybody together, man. And I know you said like the Coach French era did it for you and things like that, but yeah, you guys era did it for us.
Yeah, absolutely, man. And I'm like Dorothy, man. There's no place like home.
Oh, exactly.
There's no place like home.
Exactly. I lived in Houston for 16 years, and I have to say, when Coach Hardaway took the coaching position, I was actually jealous. I was so mad that everybody in the city of Memphis was getting to experience that, and I was stuck in Houston, and I ended up moving back in 2020. So, yeah, I very much understand that. So let's talk about, so you grew up in the 60s and the 70s as a kid in Memphis. Mm-hmm. I'm curious, as a young man in Memphis going to school and playing sports, what was it like in the 70s? How did the 70s in Memphis impact your life?
Oh man, they were very instrumental, but I mean, they was so much fun. I looked forward to going to school, you know, and I tell my daughters that because my mom still lives in the same house I was born in. Down in South Memphis, right. and yeah, she won't move. I tried, and she, you know, my mom's like, no, you can do what you want to do to help, you know, enhance what, but the house is not moving. You know, we're not right. going, and so, the neighborhoods, you know, there was a difference because, you had rivals. Let's say I stayed on the street called Radar, which is the best street, you know, ever in Memphis. I tell them it's the best street because, you know, whereas, you know, it might be some others, but it's spelled the same way forward as it is backwards.
Oh, okay, there you go.
Yeah, so there's some real significance. But the bottom half of Radar, we had so many kids. We would compete against the top half, you know, because the street went up the road, and a lot of the kids we were. Everybody went to, you know, your neighborhood school. Nowadays, it's totally different. You know, you got kids all over going different. But there was a sense of pride, you know, a sense of ownership, you know, as to where you were and you loved. I just those times, because also you had the older guys and young ladies that would mold you, and they wouldn't let you, you know, get out there and do wrong. And if you tried, they would check you quick, and then also go let mom know, you know, that you were out there not doing what you're supposed to do. And then you were in trouble. You know, you might get jumped out there and then have to go home and then get a good, yes, nice little spanking, you know. And so the fear factor was there, and it helped. It helped. Right. It helped mold us tremendously. And it did me a great deal of a good to be around people I knew that actually really, really loved me. And you know, the real love, and I was wrong, no hesitation, you know, when I was, you know, doing good, there was always, you know, encouragement and love and saying, hey man, we're so proud of you, you know.
Right. What made you choose Memphis State? You recruited? Like, what was that process? Like,
yeah, I was recruited. You know, I had one or two people that, you know, were interested in Andre, you know, and mainly a lot of the Tennessee schools, you know, at the East Tennessee States, Tennessee Tech, UT Knoxville recruited a little bit, but Ole Miss, you know, Southern Mississippi. But Auburn was, when I tell you, every week, really? Every single week. Sonny Smith was the head coach at the time. Tavesta Anderson was the assistant coach. And Tavesta Anderson was at, it seemed like he was at my game like every week. And I had made my mind up. I was going to Auburn University. And Memphis was not, you know, the first choice. And the big part of it was Sonny Smith had been to my house twice to sit down and talk to my parents in the living room. He was the head coach. And Tavesta Anderson was there every week. Dana Kirk had not been. Coach Kirk had not been to Andre Turner's house to talk to his parents. And that meant something to me that Auburn would take, you know, being from where they were from and would take out their time to come down. So they told me that they really did want me to be a part of their program. And I had about made my mind up, but a gentleman by the name of Larry Finch visited my house. And
didn't give you a choice, I'm sure.
When I tell you, he visited my house and he gave me all the pros and cons of going to college and the significance of staying at home and understanding that when basketball was over, what I was going to do with my life if perhaps professionally it didn't work, because at the time, really, I was just playing basketball. My mindset never was, okay, I'm going to the NBA. I was just loving where I was. And I had no idea when I was a young fella about playing in the NBA. And that just wasn't my dream. My dream was to play basketball, to play baseball. I even played football and ran track. And so to play all those sports and just do the best I could and follow in the footsteps, because once again, I told you, you know, the bar was already set, because not only did my oldest brother, you know, end up being a valedictorian and going to UNT Knoxville. But my next to the oldest brother, he went to Knoxville. And
my
sister went to college. And then my sister after her, she went to Knoxville and graduated in journalism. So I had four siblings before me that attended college. So I didn't have a choice, you know, about going to college. But Coach Finch, that night he came by and he talked to me for about 2 hours. And he some things I can't tell you that he said, but he convinced me that Memphis was my home and they needed a point guard that could direct the team of talent that they had put together. They just was missing the point guard, you know, to be able to direct. And so I broke down and said, okay. And then it didn't hurt that the next, I think like the little while passed and I got a chance to go to a game and they set me on the front row and I watched Keith Lee play against Louisville. And Keith Lee just politely scored 30, grabbed 15 rebounds and whooped Louisville. And I said, man, if I could play with that big fella, you know? And so that was the convincing part.
You know, what I find interesting really quickly is that Coach Finch was thinking about life after basketball for you.
He was. Absolutely, he was.
And I think that's pretty impressive, because I'm not sure how many coaches actually, you know, I don't know, but maybe they're so intent on getting the players that they're not necessarily caring about the player and the player's future. And I think that says a lot about Coach Finch, that he brought that up in conversation.
He did.
With you.
Absolutely.
We talked about that last night, about how impactful it was. Like, people had other choices, but in the long run, you're thinking in you're just thinking short term. If I go to this school, I'll play immediately. But what about your life afterwards? Right. And Coach Finch had a way of convincing you. Like I said, they can't say how what he said to me either. But you know, us. You know, me from the same high school. You know, me growing up with his dad and things like that. It was just no nonsense. He was like, here, come and sign this paper. I don't want to hear anything.
Right, right. You know, that's Coach Finch, direct. Direct, yeah, man.
Let's just get it done. So, you know, he was a closer back then. So, yeah. So, no but like I said, by doing that, by closing deal on you guys and the key fleas and the things like that, he already set the groundwork for us to come. So.
That's right.
Yeah. And that was kind of a conversation that Penny held, you know, with me as well. You know, he was like, hey, Dre, that 85 team, he said that was it. He said that was the reason why, you know, Memphis was already on my radar. He did. He told me exactly that. Yeah.
Hey, go ahead. Go ahead, Sandy.
No. Your turn.
No, it's okay. I was just saying, you guys had such a significant career. You know, careers are short now. people come, a player like your caliber would have probably stayed 1 or 2 years and probably left. You know what I mean? Left school. But we had a chance to enjoy you as long as we could, man. And so that was very impactful as well to the program and to us, because we knew we were going to have a little general. We knew that you, how you wore your wristbands. Everybody was wearing their wristbands. Everybody wiped their shoes just like you wiped your shoes during the free throw. You know what I mean? Like you were somebody else shooting the free throw, how you would wipe the wipe your shoes with your hands. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
We did it all, man. So you don't even know. See, you tripping because you laughing because you didn't know what kind of impact that had, man. So the wristbands and number 10, man, and how you wore your shorts, man, and everything, man, and just even your swagger, man, how you did it, man. So
yeah,
I just want to say thank you, man, for setting the standard for Memphis, man. That was the team, man. I mean, Sandy has a question, man, that I know she wanted to ask, and I know you had so many impactful moments, but what is your greatest college moment that you can think of?
Man, greatest college. That's on the spot for real.
Or maybe the moment that impacted you the most.
Yeah.
Probably being able to sign that letter of intent and knowing that I was, you know, about to be a Tiger and this is going to be my career, that I was going to get that opportunity. I'm going to tell you what was really significant to me was that these guys I've battled against all my life in high school. Now I'm getting an opportunity to be on the same court with them and play with as my brothers and my teammates, the entire time and getting to really know them. You know, we knew each other somewhat, but now in this close, intimate setting, as this team of Memphis State Tigers, now I really get a chance to know, you know, my guys, and there was nothing like the camaraderie, the brotherhood that we built with each other. And I think that was probably more significant than anything else. I mean, than the winning, and of course the winning was great. Now that's right. Not get that wrong, because you know we could do no wrong around Memphis. You know, Highland and eat free, you know, and in a restaurant or whatnot, and go to the beauty shops and barber shops where I get my haircut, and we sit down and talk. The little women would not let us leave the beauty shop. So if we stopped in the beauty shop, they would keep us in there, and there was like all kind of conversation that would go on, and it was just so much love during those times.
I also think that you know, you guys from Memphis, coming from different high schools, playing on the same team, I also think that it brought the city together. And just really uplifted the city. And you know, those to me are some of the advantages of recruiting hometown guys play on the team, is just kind of bringing the city together.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, Sandy. It was very significant because you could feel it. We could feel it all with, even, you know, in the losses. It was like, hey, it's okay. We're gonna be all right. You know, even when I was throwing the ball everywhere, and then it was like Andre turnover, and it was like, hey, is he gonna get it together? You know, and so I had to figure out, okay, let's slow down. Let's you know, let the game slow down to you, because you got guys around you that love you, that they're gonna help you, and so it happened, and don't get discouraged. And if perhaps I was somewhere else, and if I was in Auburn, and I was throwing it, you know, in the stands and turning over, then maybe I would be on the bench and sitting on the bench for a while, and then confidence or whatnot. But right. I was at home, and so it made a difference.
I remember that name. I wasn't gonna say anything, but I remember the name.
Oh, absolutely, Mike.
I remember the name. I'm not even gonna say the name, but I remember the name.
But
you overcome it, man. I want to talk about this podcast and why we're doing this podcast really quick. It's called The Fifth Quarter. And it's talking about the life and the struggles that some athletes or some people just changing careers, and about how change can be so scary.
Absolutely.
And so I know you had a long career. People don't know how long you played, man. And I told Sandy how long that you played, man. And she was very impressed. I didn't know you played that long myself until you played, man. But when did you know? I know you had a great career. You know, you've been in Spain, and I was very impressed that you know, you told me that you were able to do the interviews in Spanish, man. I was just like, wow. I remember us sitting at Snowden Junior High School or Central High School, and we were playing. He was like, yeah, man, I'm comfortable enough to do the interviews in Spanish. I was just like, wow. I was very impressed at that, man. So when did you know, man, that that fifth quarter began for you, like life after basketball?
And I probably would say probably not, maybe next to the last season that I played over in Spain. And it was coming down to maybe not being as significant, you know, on your team as you had been, you know, all those years, you know, the go-to guy. And I had to, you know, tell the coach, hey coach, I need a break right here. Let me go sit down for a minute. And he'd be like, okay, yeah, sit down. As soon as you're ready, go get back in though. You know, and I go sit down. You know, so I pretty much, you know, subbed myself, you know, in and out, especially over in Spain. But my last year, we, you know, I had had a really good run, and you know, I had spoken with my wife about it, and you know, my kids, they it didn't matter to them, wherever, you know, we were, they were good. They were rolling. You find out that your kids adapt way better than grown-ups do, you know, when you go to different places, than they really do. And so they were good, but it got down to my last year, really. And I playing in Zaragoza, and I was telling my wife, you know, I think this might be it. You know, I said, we'll be turning 44 this year. And if especially we can win it, I say, but I've had a long career, and you know, I think it's about time. I think our girls, really, we need to get them back, you know, to the States, and because we know that eventually that's where we're going to be, and I want to get them back and try to get them acclimated, you know, to school and life. Right. And blessings happened that we ended up winning the championship. And I said, well, what better way to end, you know, my career than win the championship in Zaragoza? And they were in the second league, so we won the championship to go back to the first division. And I know they talked to me about coming back, you know, the next year just for just to be on part of that team that was going back to the first division. But my mind was made up, and you know, when you get there mentally, it's time. And you know, physically, I still felt like I could play basketball, because I continued to, because even when I came home, I played in, you know, the third and older league, and just continued to play well into my 50s. But I felt like it was time to make that transition, and let's get into real life. Now you live your little fantasy life. Now let's get into real life. You know, with this wife of yours and these five beautiful daughters.
So, go ahead.
No, speaking of wife, man, tell us, how long have you guys been married? How long have you been married, man? And how many kids?
Hey, I have this, you know, these guards, you know, on my wife to make sure to tell her, hey, you can't leave, can't go anywhere. You got to keep on hanging on in there now. But my wife and I have, in September, be married 37 years. We've been together probably about 43, 44 years. We were, you know, little kids, you know, as a lot of folks say, oh, you got the little puppy love going, you know, we're 16 and 15 years old, but she was the one. I knew it. It smiled, laughed all the time, just had such a great personality. She was she's a beautiful girl, but she was even way more beautiful inside than she was outside. And so that's, you know, that's saying something, but, I just knew, I didn't want to lose her. And so, you know, I tried to do what I could to hold on to it, and I'm still holding.
Okay, I have a girl question.
Okay.
So do you remember the first time you saw her?
I do. We were at the community center.
I can't tell if you're blushing right now or not.
we were at the community center, and she laughs because I tell her that, you know, that she was playing at the other end. You know, she was, you know, pretty good. But the other end where
basketball?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. My wife played basketball as well. She played at the University of Memphis as well. She played at Memphis State. Yeah.
So maybe we have her on the podcast.
Hey, why not? Yeah. We would love it. I tell her she ought to get out of that shy mode and come on, let's get to talking on this podcast. But she was down there playing at the other end with the guys that weren't as good as, you know, you had to be pretty good at that, you know, to play at the big end. You just, yeah. anybody couldn't play down there with us, you know. And so those guys, so she was playing down there with those guys, and those girls used to whoop up on those guys down there too. But I told her, I said, I remember Diana Hoop, and I said, it was something about those cherry cloth gym shorts that she had on. I said, so who wears cherry cloth gym shorts, you know, as hooping shorts? But those are the shorts that she had on, and she laughs to this day when I tell her about, so that was kind of the drawing card. I said, hey, the girl down there with cherry cloth gym shorts, and she can shoot the basketball on top of it. And she didn't live, you know, too far away. And I just, one of those days, it was funny because one of the guys outside, they were, you know, they were mailing and mailing with her, whatnot. And I would, you know, say stuff to her. And then she asked, one day, could you just walk me outside? I was like, oh absolutely. And I walked out and ended up walking out all the way to her house. And, you know, she was, yeah, it wasn't far away. So I walked all the way really to the top of her street. And she was like, thank you. And I was like, she didn't know it. I was like, my pleasure the whole time. But from that moment, and then she finally, you know, finally school started, and she, you know, was in 10th grade and I was in 11th, you know, at Mitchell, and we began dating. And as they say, you know, the rest of it, you know, we're still hanging and enjoying each other and enjoying, ooh, babies and grandbabies.
That's right. You have 4 grandbabies, right?
No, you got 6.
6 now. I watched an old interview with you.
So you got six now. and you actually ruled right, because it could be old, because these are very new. Yeah, I have one grandchild that's probably a week old.
Congratulations.
The other one's about 7 months. The other one's about 7 months. So it was 4, probably, you know, before that interview you had.
Yeah. Are they all girls also?
I have all girls in my house that I raised, but I have 4 grandsons.
And that's kind of interesting. That's kind of interesting.
Yeah, my girls gave me my boys. I knew my boys were coming somewhere.
Yeah, we used to mess with Dre during the summer.
All the time.
About all the girls he had, you know what I mean?
all the time.
Yeah, so, I know family is very important to you, man. And when that time was over and you knew it was over, and did you know what you wanted to do next? If not, were you afraid?
Did not.
Were you nervous?
Initially I wasn't, but I did not know what it is that I was going to do. I knew what I wanted to do. I wanted to, if at all possible, go and be a part of the University of Memphis staff. I said, let me come home, and if there's an opportunity for me to interview, to go and be a part of the University of Memphis staff. And the first interview I had was with Coach Calipari. I interviewed, Coach Calipari pretty much, you know, had his staff that he wanted, and we talked about a position. But as I told him at the time, I have a wife and I have kids that I have to support, and so the salary, you know, and the position he was talking about was we were not on the same page with that particular position, and he and I ended up having a really good relationship, and so I ended up having a basketball camp there and reached out to Coach Calipari. Didn't hesitate. He didn't hesitate to come down to the Mitchell and speak to, you know, my kids and pitchers, the whole nine. But I didn't. And I spent probably 8, 9, 10 months trying to figure it out, And, you know, I was still okay, you know, freshly coming from, you know, overseas. And my wife and I were getting acclimated with the kids in school. And so I was, you know, I was kind of in a little gray area, trying to figure out what it is that I really want to do. And then I get a phone call from a good friend of mine who was working with the Shelby County School System, and they were having a career fair. And he just wanted me to come down and check out the fair. And it was on a Friday. And he was like, just come down and see what we have going on. And the guy was named Michael Tony. And so I went down and was at the career fair, and they had breakout sessions for the kids before they would be able to go out on the floor to go visit the different vendors. And the breakout sessions were, you know, preparation, and it was kind of talking about life skills and whatnot. And so 4 of the individuals didn't show. 4 of the presenters didn't show. And so the director at the time was Miss Willie Slate, and she asked me, she said, hey, how would you like sitting in on one of the you know, breakout sessions? And I was like, Miss Slater, I came down here. You seeing these nice little duds? I came down here just to enjoy myself, to walk around the career fair and see what was going on in the fair, you know. And so they had to the tune of about 125 vendors then. So I just wanted to walk around and check out the vendors, peep in at the, you know, peep in on. Long story short, I ended up doing four of them.
Wow.
I ended up doing four sessions, and each session was 30 minutes. And so when the day was ending, Miss Slate stopped me and said, Andre, I'd like to, you know, for you to come see me on Monday morning. And I did. And when I came in, she offered me a job that very day. And she was like, so when can you start? And I was like, well, give me about a week or so. Let me think. let me get myself together. And then, you know, man, but from there, and she, you know, explained to me that, you know, it wasn't, she didn't want to have me sitting in a chair at a desk the entire time. She wanted me to be out in the field and, you know, working with the our students. And man, I had about a 13-year career with Shelby County School System.
So what subject did you teach?
Oh, I didn't teach. I was with CTE, which was career. We started out as CTAE, which was Career Technical and Adult Education, because MESIC had adult education at their school at the time. And so we were also partnered with MESIC, okay, where we would help the adult students with their classes. And so I was responsible for a lot of time really locating those students and then help the students get acclimated, you know, to the program. And Miss Slate, she just was so wonderful, and because she made sure that I stayed visible and stayed out there, you know, in the field working with. And so we began after messing with down, we ended up being Career Technical Education, which is all of the pretty much the you know, your cosmetology, your barbering, all your life skill classes. And so it was like a perfect marriage, because I that side with the really the educational side of Shelby County school system, it was so good and so educational for me, first and foremost, to learn it and then to be able to implement it and then talk in different sets with different people about how important this side was, because not every kid wants to go to college.
That's right.
But there is so much more for them to do after. And a lot of those kids that went into the CTE fields, they ended up having their own businesses and would come back and we would let them, you know, speak and talk about their experiences and what it is that they were doing there. And so, you know, the HVAC, electrical, and these kids, when you learn these are things that you know, this is life. And so you take this to, you know, things in your own house that you're able to do and save yourself a lot of money with learning these different trades is what they were.
Right.
Beautiful,
right,
man.
Yeah.
Dre, I know we did similar paths. Both of us went back and got that paper after our career was over with.
Yeah.
And I know it meant a lot for me to my family and my kids to see me walk across that stage, man. What did it mean to you? Because I remember you said, you know, you didn't have time to be depressed. You had that family to take care of.
Yeah, Mike. And I'm glad you mentioned that, because that was the other part. Like I said, I was thinking and trying to figure out what I was going to do, but I wasn't depressed, because, I had a wife and I had kids that I had to get up and say, okay, let's get them to school.
That's right.
And so actually during that time, and then I jump on that, but actually during that time, I did a lot of that. I did a lot of taking my kids to school, picking them up, you know, going on field trips. I had another one of them, the fathers that would be on field trips with me, and all the kids would want to be with us, because, you know, we were going to make it fun, you know. And so we were going to the zoo, and I'm holding kids' hands that not even my own kids. So my kids are going to play, you know, with the other kids. And so I'm holding hands with the kids that, you know, I didn't know, but I began to get to know. But it was a really good time, because I got a chance to, you know, go to the program, go to the honors programs where my kids were, you know, at 9 o'clock in the morning. If I was, you know, working then, you know, I would miss those things. But there was a lot of quality time and events that I was able to make, you know, with my kids. And I know that they loved it, because you would just see it in their eyes. And then, you know, 12 o'clock, 11:30, you know, I would go to McDonald's and bring the McDonald's, and I would sit in the, you know, in the cafeteria.
They love you.
Eat with my kid, you know, eat with my daughter, man. And then sometimes, you know, I'd come in there every once in a while, maybe I'd come in there and say, oh, we got nuggets. And so just bring a whole gang of Nuggets and say, and you know, sometimes I might get in a little trouble because, you know, the teacher's like, hey, Mr. Turner, you cannot bring food for everybody in the cafeteria. You're going to cause a real stir, you know, around here. But I just love watching those kids smile, man, and just being around them. That's, you know, because I'm still a kid at heart. I can't change, and you know, I'll be this way until you know, I leave here. But I just love watching the smiles and enjoying those kids, but enjoying the quality time with my own kids, though, you know, right, was really big, you know, at that particular point too. Now what, and the other part we were just talking about,
what was the other getting part?
This what happened with age.
Getting the what now?
No, I say this is what happened with age.
Oh.
Getting that paper, getting that degree, going back.
And so, and that's what happened with age. That's right. So, man, Mike, you talk about that piece of paper, man. I ended up getting my degree before any of my daughters finished high school. And I really wanted that to be on the wall before they finished anything. And so I did. And the only regret was that because my grandmother was the initiator of hey, I'd come home during, you know, the summertime, and you know, you've been over in Spain for 9 months, and so you get 3 months to kind of, or two and a half really, to relax. And grandma's favorite line would be, so when we're going back, it's like, hey, grandma, can I relax? Can I, you know, kind of enjoy? Nope. How about let's go eat lunch together, you know, and let me shower you a little bit. You're like, yeah, that sounds good. So when are you going to start to get it, you know? And she stayed on me. And I was so grateful and so blessed to have a grandmother that cared, you know, that much about me getting that piece of paper. And the only regret is when I got it, you know, she wasn't there. My grandmama lived to be 95 years old.
Wow.
And but she wasn't there. But I knew she was watching, sure, you know, down there, and was saying, well, a little sonny boy finally did it. I'm halfway proud of him. She probably was saying it took him long enough to get it, but he did get it, you know. but I was proud you know, and as I walked across the stage, it was all her, you know, just going through me and all over me and saying, grandma, I did it. I got it, because I knew there was a significance in getting as well, because through certain doors you cannot go without a degree, you know, and regardless of what type of degree, but sometimes you just have to have, you know, that degree. Right. And it made a difference, because it really made a difference to my kids. And so, you know, I have my fourth one now, who's at the University of Memphis. She's about to graduate and with an art degree. And she's already, you know, been internships and excited about being an art teacher. So, you know, she's going right into it, and she already knows. And so it warms my heart to know, you know, that, you know, she knows exactly what she wants to do.
I had a quick question about living in Spain, and I obviously it's Castilian Spanish over there, instead of Mexican Spanish.
Absolutely.
And you had to learn that. What was it like playing basketball with people that could not speak the same language, and how did that kind of impact you?
It was
play?
So much fun, Sandy. And I tell you, it was fun. It was so much fun. At the beginning, it was a little different, because I was in a little place in northern Spain called Orense. It's in the Galician region, and no one spoke Spanish. No one. The head coach, a guy by the name of Tim Shea, but they call him like Tim Shea. They put it all together now because he's been there so long. And right. So I think they've colonized him. He's Spanish now. He's not American right. anymore, but he's from New York. But he was the only one that spoke Spanish. And then we ended up having an assistant coach, which was just crazy. It blew me away. But a guy by the name of John Tree Washington was the assistant coach. Mm-hmm. And John Tree Washington was a Memphis State Tiger.
Absolutely.
John Tree was a Memphis State Tiger. And John passed, I guess, last year. I think it was last year. But John was the assistant coach, and John spoke Spanish as well. And we had so many stories together over in Spain. But it was different, but it was it was intriguing just to be over there. And what I began to find out after I got out of their stubbornness, whereas, hey, I don't need to learn this language. All I need to know is when that check is going to hit my bank account, and play these games and I'm good. What time is practice? But what I learned was when I began to try to embrace the culture, they just took me over and my family. My wife, in the games, she would never be able to hold our child, but she would be able to enjoy the game because they wanted to hold the babies all the time.
My gosh.
And they took the babies out of our hands. And so my wife would be able to cheer and watch the games. And they just, when I tell you, they are so loving, so warm, so family oriented. The Spanish people are, and I mean, the grandparents are always with the grandkids, and it was a huge big middle class country, because Right. Everybody had a place, a house, and then everybody had a getaway. It was like they all had a place that was by the water, and everybody, and it was like, well, you have to come see us doing, come hang out with us and your family. And my wife and I, we did, we had, made so many different friends, and when you embrace their culture, they embrace you even more. And so they were the ones. I never took a class in Spanish, not one time. My teammates were the ones who taught me Spanish. It was through my teammates.
What do you think that your kids, like living over there, what were some of the benefits that impacted them more so than if they had grown up in the States?
Well, number one, they began to be bilingual.
Which is important these days.
Oh, absolutely. I have one daughter that works for MLGW, and she mans her own post because she gets all kind of calls, Spanish, English, but she mans her own post. She's the only one in there that mans her own post with at the call center. Right. But that was first and foremost. But the other thing was culturally, my babies see people. They absolutely see people. They don't see color at all.
Right.
And they, at times when we would come home and we would have birthday parties for my daughters, and people would come by and see my kids out in the yard playing, you had every, to an extent, ethnicity that you could think of that was out there. And my babies just were enjoying themselves. And I love that about them, because they are absolutely people oriented. They love you. They don't love who you are or where you come from, and they love you. And if you're not, if there's a bad you, then they don't like you. if you show the bad, then you're trying not to do good. Then you're not their cup of tea. And so they love genuinely. And so I love that about my babies, and they're so that they understand customer service. They understand, what customer service means, that it's not about you.
Right.
Don't get blindsided and think that you're in this world and everything's about you. Nah, you're supposed to be able to enjoy yourself and have and do things, but it's not about you. It's not about you at all. And I was blessed enough to learn that early myself and know that my life is for somebody else. It's to be impactful and to be, about somebody else.
Right.
Trey, you still can't walk around town, man, without them calling your whole name. They don't call you Andre. They call you Andre Turner. Like when I go home, they call my whole name. I'm like, right. Hey, man, don't call my whole name.
And that's funny, because when they do that, you say, don't call my whole name. And people do that, say, Andre Turner. I say, hey, don't do that. The people might be looking for me. I say, the police might be out there looking for me.
Yeah. They call your whole name, man.
And they do. So, they do, Mike. They do. But I love it. I love it.
How do you want to be remembered?
Man, remembered. I know y'all, you talk about, my smile and, kind of how I am, as a jovial or a jolly individual. I love life. I really do. But I want to be remembered as somebody who cared, about others, way more than he cared about himself. First of all, I always want to see it, somebody else smile, somebody else being lifted up, somebody else being able to get something, and or have a breakthrough. And that warms me. That does so much for me. And my wife gets on me a lot of times. She's like, "Oh, you're so emotional, man. You have to be so emotional." I'm like, "Hey, sister, just let me be me, okay? Can I be me?" You know, but I love it, and it goes both ways, you know, with the emotions. But you know, I want to be, you know, that you know, remembered as you know, that individual that loved hard, that cared hard, that enjoyed life, you know, because I you know, you want to enjoy. If you don't enjoy life, you know, something's wrong. And not so much as I learned from my, you know, my brother, my oldest brother said, you know, he was like, "Hey, you know, don't worry so much about tomorrow. Just prepare, you know." So that worrying is what, you know, kind of breaks you down and has that anxiety and whatnot. So don't worry as much. Just prepare, and because there's nothing you can do about tomorrow, because it's not here. You know what you can, you know, do something about is today. You know, yesterday is gone, and so let's live for today and see, you know, how we can make, you know, today a, you know, a better day for, you know, somebody else and yourself.
So you mentioned anxiety. Did you have any anxiety playing in high school or college or even in the pros?
Anxiety. I had nervousness. You know, I get nervous right now today saying, we're about to play a game. We're about to play a game out there saying, and I know, you know, the people are going to be out there. And so they're the little butterflies, you know, and I think that has always helped and prepared me. So if I was a game and I didn't feel those butterflies, like, "Oh Lord, what's about to happen today?" You know, I'm not prepared. I'm not ready, you know, but those butterflies always let me know and say, "Hey, there's some excitement. Something's good about to happen today." And so that did it. But maybe a little anxiety when, you know, you were playing in the NBA and now it was time for them to decide who are they going to keep and not. So, for instance, when I was drafted by the Lakers and I had a pretty good summer league where, you know, I had done, you know, pretty decent and scored, and we had won a few games, and it came down to like 3 days before we were getting ready to play the first regular season game. And they brought me into the office and they had 13 names on the list, and it was check marks by all the names and an X mark by one name. And as I got down the row and saw that X by my name, I was like, "Oh Lord, that can't be good." Checks by the rest of them. And that was, you know, that I guess you say a little anxiety, you know, in that it's like, "Now, so what's going to happen next?" Man, I got cut. And so what's next? You know, what am I going to do next? Yeah, because I really wanted to make this team, and I thought you know, was going to make the team, and I didn't. And so now, you know, let's pick up the pieces and you know, and so, yeah, I cried. But the other blessing was that my wife was there too. So I had somebody, you know, to cry to, you know, that, you know, that moment. And we talked about it and said, "All right, next thing, let's get back on this plane. Let's get back to Memphis and, you know, let's see what's next." And, you know, my representative about, you know, perhaps going to, you know, the CBA and plan. But as it would happen, a week later, my phone rung and it was Jan Volk, who was the general manager of the Boston Celtics at the time. And he was like, "Hey, Andre, how fast can you be on the plane to get back to Boston? Can you be on that plane tomorrow?" I said, "No, I probably be on that plane in about a few hours. Just next to the next plane leaves out here into Boston, and that's the plane I'm on, Jan." You know, and so I did. I ended up going to Boston right after leaving LA a week later, and was there for like a good month and a half, and then ended up going to the CBA and finishing out the season.
Oh wow! Hey, Andre, someone asked me, was there any pressure on us when I was playing? But I always say that we knew that you guys were watching. Yeah. Were you guys watching us? And did you guys, we wanted you guys to have the bragging rights.
Absolutely, man.
Because we knew you guys were watching. Chris knew that Andre Turner was watching him.
No doubt.
William Bedford, me being from the same high school, he was watching me.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. So,
no doubt.
Did we make you guys proud?
You talking about watching? We were not just watching; we were glued. We were glued to the TV when our guys were playing, and man, those, and whatever play that was made, you know, we, of course, we we, you know, critiqued the whole nine, you know, about certain things. You know, we were going to do it because we were critiqued for sure while we were playing. Right. But we did that. And then we would watch mannerisms and say, come on now, man, you can't act like that now after, you know, play, you know, come on, just get on back on defense, you know, and you know, get it back this end. But man, those spectacular plays and maybe throw it over the backboard and Michael Wilson would go get it. We was like, ooh. And I would mess with Slim. So Slim, I don't know if you get up that high, you know. And he'd be like, Dre, you know I go get that ball. And I'm like, I don't know, man. And I said, Mike touching the top of that backboard going to get it, man, you know. Yeah. And so we were super proud. And so that was, you know, we were always in the midst of people from other schools. And so it was like, man, you know, y'all at school could mess with us, man. I said, y'all, you see what our guys out there doing, you know? And so, man, guys made us proud, man. And saying, once again, being from the city, it was like, that's our city. I said, these guys are from our city representing, right. You know? And so that did it for us. Absolutely, that did it for us.
Yeah, Sandy talked about anxiety. And I feel when you explain it, I have more anxiety watching Tiger games than I did playing Tiger games.
I do too. I cannot, like, if the score is like within even 10 points and there's a minute left on the clock, sometimes I have to turn the television on.
Come on, Sandy. Or, you gotta fight through it, man.
Or I will mute those people on ESPN.
And just watch the game, man.
I just watch the game because it just makes me crazy.
And that's something you say that too, because I get it now, even today, that you know, because I young ladies, and I call them all young ladies because they're absolutely beautiful, young, mature women, at those good ages of 60s and 70s, and so I get it today. It was like, you know, you aged me, and I was like, no, you know exactly what I'm talking about too, Turner. And I was like, no, how would I age you? Like, you wait till the last second.
That's right.
Why can't you just get the game over with about a 20 point lead, but you want to wait till the last second and then make those shots, and my heart just a pounding, and I don't know if I'm gonna have a heart attack or what. You know? And then I see Pounce, you know, and they remember the Tiger mascot name, and everything. And we see Pounce on the ground, and they try to revive him, you know. And I say, well, you know, games happen like that sometimes, and I just was blessed and fortunate enough to be able to make one or two of those shots.
I remember those shots. I thought you were going to mention them, man, but when I asked you about the favorite part of your career, I remember those last second shots you hit, man. So it's a part of Memphis history, man. So.
Absolutely.
I think when I was doing my research on you, I read that, I guess it was the 85, like the last three games, you made the winning shots of every one of those games.
I got a little lucky, Sandy. Just
a little lucky.
Yeah, they, you know.
Ball. I'm gonna tell you what my coach used to tell me. He said, "Only a fool would look at the skills of a man of that nature and call it luck, man. It was no luck."
So. Yeah, and the thing about it is, you had to want to take the shot. You know, you had to, you know, be okay with it not going in. And, and I was, because I knew that I had a huge supporting cast. My teammates believed in me. 3,000%, and I knew that. And so when I would take those shots, and it become kind of a little ritual, because Keith would get in foul trouble, and it was like, okay, somebody has to, you know, get keep the game going. And with Keith getting foul trouble, I felt like, okay, Andre, let's pick it up a little bit offensively, you know, and get your other guys involved, but pick it up yourself a little bit offensively. And I was a scorer. You know, which I told guys they didn't know, but I was a scorer in high school. You know, that's what I did. And I was in high school. I led the city in scoring. My senior year, but I was always a point guard. And so I understood by getting the basketball to my guys. And so it was easy for me to make that transition from being a scorer and then coming to the university, coming to Memphis State, and then having to Keith Lee and William Bedford and, you know, Dwight Boyd, Vincent Askew, Baskerville Holmes, you know, Willie Becton, you know, all these guys that I could pass the basketball to, and Doom Haynes, Bobby Parks, you know, I definitely can't forget about these guys, my first year and stuff. So it was an easy transition for me.
So what do you tell the kids today? Because you're coaching at Lane and you coached at Mitchell. What do you tell them today? Because even when I'm watching games, I see a lot of times the players are looking up at their stats. And with social media and just everything around, you know, their rankings and all those things, what do you tell the guys about playing as a team and not trying to score and get the stats?
And that's something, Sandy. That's a great question, because there's a lot, and that's like a loaded question when
it is a loaded question,
and dealing, you know, dealing with these guys today, because it's so much and these variables that are around them, and so many people that In their ear, you know, about the how great their talent is, and you know how they should be maybe perhaps somewhere else, or they have the ability to go, you know, to the next level. And some of the people around them hadn't gone anywhere, you know, hadn't done anything,
hadn't even played basketball.
Yeah. Saying, but they've watched it, so they know, you know, they've been in, you know, this fire. No, but my conversation is, I try to keep it as fundamental and basic as possible about them, especially when we're talking about team. That with my guys, excuse me. That with my guys, my conversation is always be the best version of you. If you play great defense, then be that guy, you know, on the floor. Don't be the guy that plays great defense and then come out here and shoot 5 3-pointers and know you shooting 13% from, you know, 3-point line. You're not helping us. I said, be that guy that helps us be the best team that we can be. So each individual, I make it a point to have a personal relationship with each one of the guys, because you have to know each one of them, you know, their characteristics, their personalities, you know, how you can motivate them, what motivates them. And because if I'm screaming at Sandy full time and Sandy is taking it in and going out there and just playing hard regards, but then here I am trying to scream at Mike, and Mike's like, man, I'm so tired of hearing coach with that. But so in other words, I go the opposite way and say, hey, Mike, I really need you.
Right.
Man, today, hey, and you go get 10 rebounds, man, score 10. I say, I promise you, we're going to win. So I got to have you. You're extremely important to us. And so there's, you know, different avenues that you have to have. And so I try to be honest, make sure I'm honest with, you know, my guys, but at the same time, be honest with them about what it is that they do well for us to be successful. And then to continue to probe and make sure that my assistant coach is on that same page with me when we're talking to these guys and making them understand that, hey, Coach Turner is going to make a lot of mistakes. Coach Turner has to get better each day. You guys are going to help Coach Turner get better. I said, but I want you to be able to listen to a little bit of knowledge that Coach Turner has that he's played and coached for a little while, you know, this game. Right. And be receptive. Be receptive, because I am. You know, I'm you guys have some, because you're on the floor and you see things sometimes. And so don't be afraid to come and tell me what it is that you see. And then I clap my hand and say, let's go get it. Let's go try it. You know, let's see, you know, if it works. And so I try to be as open and be a player's coach, you know, because when you played it, you know, you want to be a player's coach. You kind of understand.
Right.
You don't have all the answers, but you try your best. And you know, when you don't have them, I'm not afraid, you know, to ask and to have these ears, you know, wide open and listening to, you know, what individuals have to tell me.
Right.
I think that's a great job. A coach does have to humble himself, and you're also in a constant state of learning. And, yeah, I always say it when I was coaching, not on the level that you were, but anything you get offensively is just a plus. It's just like gravy. It's the intangibles. It's the rebounds. It's the defense. But when you're making shots, that just makes it that much more easy.
Absolutely. Absolutely, yeah. Mike. The thing that don't show up on the stat sheet.
Yeah, I got a question for you, man. This is I don't have any more, but this is the question, man. You seem like you've had a pretty good career, man, and you've worked really hard. If you can talk to a young Andre Turner, that 14-year-old or whatever, I mean, what would you tell that Andre Turner?
Man, Mike, look at boy. We always talk about hindsight. If I knew, you know, what I know now, you know, back then, you know, what would let me tell you, I don't know about the 14-year-old, but let me tell you about the 17, 18-year-old that was getting ready to go to Memphis. And I could tell him something. Hey, there's opportunities for you there. And you can make the best of it. I was so involved with nothing but basketball and books that I didn't see, you know, the outside, and other individuals did. Other, you know, some people, you know, did see it, and the benefits, if I could, you know, say, you know, because I never. I just was such a little country fella, you know. I just, you know, it's who I was and who I still am. That I was you know, geared straight toward basketball. And I knew that if I didn't get the books, I couldn't play basketball, because that was, you know, instilled in me early by mom and dad. Okay, you bring home. And then it was like C's. I was at a point where I didn't like C's on my report card. Yeah. And so, you know, we would fight, but you know, that's tough. I guess it would be, you know, more so to be even more, a little more way around it. Listening to, you know, and being able to see a few other things, as opposed to being so not so much as shallow minded, but you know, just the tunnel vision, you know, that vision a little more open about, you know, things that were happening, opportunities that probably, you know, were there, things you could have impacted to help out, perhaps even maybe your family, you know, right. You know, some more, but I honestly can say, Mike, that I, you know, the way that I've gone through, you know, life and the things that have happened to me, man, I'm pretty good. I'm pretty good with the things that have happened. And, you know, I thank God that he has blessed me the way that he, you know, that he's had. He's put the people in my life, because so many have, man, you say touch and molded Andre Turner. There's a lot of people. I get to try to name the people. This podcast will be for another 5 hours, you know, talking about all the individuals that impacted my life and that helped me get to, you know, the point that, you know, I'm in, you know, that I'm, you know, at right now, you know, this day of my life.
I was curious about, what was it like the first time you coached in FedEx Forum? Because that was, you guys have played Memphis twice.
Right. Absolutely. Yes. Sandy.
And I saw both of them. What was it like that first game coaching in FedEx for?
Sandy, you're talking about chill bumps. Oh, man, that was the feeling was, and even before they got to, you know, calling the star lineup out, and then, you know, the head coach. Just walking through there and just hugging on, you know, the people.
A lot of love from the crowd.
Oh, man. And it was even before then, just, you know, before the game, because I came out before the game, and just going through the crowd and just hugging on and seeing, you know, the people there and Andre, come here, you know, and that has always done it for me. You know, and I know it might sound, you know, look cliche, look corny, but that's always done it for me. Just the love that I've received. Right. And I say that exceeds all the trophies and plaques and those accolades that I have, that I can still see and put on the walls and all that. The love that I've received, that I still receive, that I will continue to receive, I hope and pray, from especially my hometown. I mean, from people around this world, you know, it's fine, but from Memphis, you know, I can still go down to the neighborhood and they love me, you know, and I love them, you know, and it's humbling, you know, it keeps you because what they'll do too, they'll love on you and hug on you, and then next thing you know, they'll crack a joke about you, you know.
Yeah,
that's like, love. Okay, that's I'm love. At home. That's yeah, love, I'm at home. That's that real love. And so that moment, being in that FedEx Forum was, you know, I guess kind of surreal. And it's like, man, I'm at home and I'm actually coaching inside the FedEx Forum and having an opportunity, you know, Penny and myself, you know, to coach, you know, against, you know, one another, two of Memphis, you know, own.
Greatest.
I let Mike put the greatest on there, but two of Memphis' own. And you know, I say it doesn't get a whole lot better than this, you know, right now at this moment, you know. But, you know, I loved it, though, saying I loved it.
So what do you think your best asset is?
Ooh, Lord, do I have one?
Everybody has one.
Do they say that? I don't know what I'm saying. Well, I don't know. You know, I think my I guess I'll say one is just being a people's person. I love conversating. It doesn't matter who it is. They could be, you know, 6 months old, and I could grab the baby and hold it, especially if it's a baby girl. I can figure out how to make her laugh, you know, and make her feel warm and make her feel okay. If they're 10 years old, you know, I got a conversation with them, you know, 18, you know, talk about life and what's you getting into. Yeah, I mean, you know, I think that was part of the reason why it was, you know, majoring in business, you know, but personnel administration, I just felt like I in that personnel department, being able to deal with and talk right. to people, you know, on a personal level, you know, on a business level, you know, on just a, you know, social level, just, you know, just being, and what I try to do is I try to be me. I can be the best version of me. Now, other people, I don't know how good I can be, you know, right. you know, right. of them, but me, I can do a pretty good version of Andre. So I try to make sure that Andre shines through, you know, each time.
Do you talk to your current students, your players, about life after basketball?
Every day, Sandy. Every day.
What is some advice that you give them or that you reinforce on a regular basis?
Well, where they are right now. So guys, y'all think that getting up on time and making it to school on time is not going to affect you later in life. I said, this is what basketball does. Basketball, I say, in sports, period.
Right.
Our life teachings, because like I say, being on time, being respectful, being accountable, being responsible. It's all of these things, having a work ethic. All of these things are life skills, and so you make sure that each day, you know, when one of these guys show up late, you know, it's like so you're at Amazon, and now you show up, you know, and now. Your boss come over and talk to you and you dock your pay. I said, so what is the dock pay for, you know, right. what is it, you know, the payment for here, for you not being on time here? I said, so you ought to be good. I said, no, I tell you what, the dock pay for you today is you get to sit in the middle of the court and the rest of your teammates are going to run for your mistake. And that's what's going to happen. You're going to sit here and you're going to watch them. Yeah, you're going to watch them.
And I
put, you know, those, we either get the 17s, we go side to side on 17s, you got to make it in a minute, or we get, you know, the 10 sprints, and let's get it. Let's get it. And so now I continue to talk about coach holding you accountable, but when you guys begin to hold each other accountable, I said, now we're embarking on something. Now we're going right. somewhere, you know, with this team concept. I said, because right now you don't get it. I said, but so when it happens, I know guys are looking at me a little crazy when I, you know, but Mike knows about that. You know, coaches have done this, you know, forever, right. you know, make the other team, mess up the guys, you know, do it.
Okay. I have one more and then I'll turn it over to Michael if he wants to end it. So, I just lost my train of thought.
That's what happened.
So where do you see yourself in 5 years? Because you're still in your fifth quarter. So where do you see yourself in 5 years?
Yeah, and I'm new, Sandy. That's the good thing, because I told her I'm still a rookie.
I'm a rookie,
Sandy, yeah. Especially at coaching, and I love what I do. And so in 5 years, Sandy, I love where I am. So let me make sure
I don't want to
emphasize that, you know,
right.
I
want Lane College to think
right,
you're leaving.
Right. Dre trying to get out of it. No,
I know.
but we all have aspirations. And to coach on a Division I level, absolutely. I would love to. And so what you do is, you know, you make the best of where you are. But right. in 5 years, you know, I would love to be coaching in a Division I. Where? You know, I right now it doesn't particularly, you know, matter. You know, just as long as I can be there, impacted, and trying to win a national championship, saying
right,
and get that national championship.
Yes, absolutely. Okay, Mike.
Dre, I know that 85 team was stacked and loaded. I always say our team, our 94, 95 team, 10 years later, we were stacked and loaded as well. How you think we would have done compared with you guys?
Man, look, Mike, y'all squad, y'all were gritty and athletic. Y'all just weren't quite big enough, Mike. You know,
I'm thinking this though, Dre. You know, you have the Befford, we got Lorenzen, you got Keith Lee. I'm not saying that we got Big Dave. You know, I'm not saying that's a push. I know who Keith is.
You got some.
I got you and I got Chris. Both of y'all speed demons and both of y'all not bagging down.
Yeah.
You got Big Vincent Askew. We have Cedric Henderson.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
You got Dwight Boyd. We got Mingo Johnson.
Yeah.
But you got to think, I know y'all had a squad though, but we coming off that bench is coming off that bench, man. You got myself. You got Rodney Newsome. You got Justin Wimmer. Man, and I know you can name us some off the bench. Not
no doubt. You know, I bet go together.
Because we running the same tip play. You know we're trying to run the same tip play. We trying to run the same tip play that we
right. So get it. Y'all before I get that back pick, you know Slim going and I know, you know, y'all doing the same thing. But that would have been a good game, Mike. I think we you know, you put those together because they tried to throw, you know, the other team, you know, they Coach Finch, Keenan, Ronnie Robinson.
Yes.
And yeah, you got to look at them now. You get to talk about Tubman shooting that ball and Keenan, you know, and Ronnie Robinson.
That big 85 cat going squad, again. Though, dog. That 85 squad, though, man.
But our squad, it was, you know, we had a few things with us, Mike. We had a few things with us.
I know.
I think we'd have competed well against any of the other groups. We'd have competed pretty good.
You'll just leave it at that.
Yeah,
a while back before, you know, I'm a University of Memphis guy, and I know you're a Memphis State guy, but we all family.
You know,
and before you guys got a little bit too old, me and Elliot, we were actually talking about having a Memphis State versus the University of Memphis game. Man. That would have been unbelievable. That would have been unbelievable, man.
Because I would have shown up and gotten ready to get hold to Elliot Perry. So
my question is, why can't you still have one?
What?
I think maybe the Memphis State players are maybe a little too long.
With the video game, Sandy?
No,
William Befford and Keith Lee, they are not getting on anybody's court. That's for sure. Let alone running up and down. You know, they're not even gonna get on the court.
We can give them 6 months to get in shape.
I don't play basketball anymore because I don't disrespect the game because I still think I can play like what I was when I was in my 20s.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So. And your mind is the last thing to go, but your body's like, whoa,
slow it down.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, we're laughing and you know, we had our big fundraiser this past Saturday, and it's called Dinner with the Pros. And so former NFL, NBA guys to come in and play. And so, you know, and then, you know, you get some overseas and whatnot. And so you just kind of mix them in. So I hadn't done anything in about 3 months. So I stay on the treadmill. You know, I get my treadmill going, and you know, I try to lift my little weights here and there, try to keep up a little strength, saying, you know, and so I hadn't done anything about 3 months, and the guy was like, you gotta play, and so I did.
Oh,
and so I had enough sense to take a couple of ibuprofen before the game.
Oh my god,
you know, but I played the game and surprised myself because at the end of the game I was okay. The next day on Sunday I woke up and I said, Okay, we're still intact. We just not totally broke down. Now Monday came, and on the right side, the lower back, you know, you know. And so I was down there with the trainer yesterday. Our trainer here in Lane, and I told Heather, oh, I'll be back down. I have a podcast to do and a couple of things on the computer. I said, but I'll be back down for my treatment though. So you put them stems on me and he'd pack, you know.
Yes,
yeah,
that's an old school trick, Dre. That's to take the ibuprofen before. I would start doing that. Yeah.
Oh,
don't
absolutely.
Wait till afterwards. You take it before because you know it's coming.
Yeah, absolutely, Mike. It makes sense, you know, as to get a little older and learn a little bit more. Just, you know, at least get a little wiser. You know, I try to get a little wiser, you know, as I age a little bit.
That's right.
Yeah, I want to close out by saying this. You know, we talked to your center that you had at Memphis State. And he said, man, out of all his career, man, you are the best point guard he ever played with.
Man, I love him.
He said you were, man. He had a lot of great things to say about you, man. And I also want to say, man, thank you, man. Thank you for paving the way. Thank you for accepting my phone call. Thank you for calling me back immediately, man.
Stop, Mike. Oh, yeah.
I mean, I know we're Tiger brothers.
Yeah,
and we're brothers in life, man. So I just want to say thank you, man, and thank you for the time that you spent with us today, man. It was incredible. Like I told Sandy, like I got Andre Turner, and her reply was, "Oh my God!" You know what I mean?
So I want to say one thing though, because I know some people might be out there wondering, but you know, I came to college in 1986, and I came from a really small town. We talked about that, McKenzie, Tennessee. Right. Mm-hmm. And I had never watched Memphis State basketball. And I didn't even really, I liked basketball, but it didn't really like enter my mind. But the one thing that I learned about, and it was probably my first year there, I ran into Marvin Alexander and Sylvester Gray coming out of the field house. Never seen men that large in my entire life. Right. But, you know, and I'm a history person, but the whole thing about, you know, people ask me why I love Memphis basketball. And it was something, if I go back and look at it, because I was born just a few months after Dr. King was killed. Hmm. And for me, it was just, I saw literally how basketball brought the city together.
Absolutely.
And I loved going to the games and just seeing the excitement and everything. And even though I didn't watch you play, I still had this reverence for you, like everybody that came before. Right. And to me, it's just, you know, it embodies Memphis basketball embodies Memphis. And I just, for me, it's just an honor. And I appreciate you taking the time out today and learning more about you and hopefully embarrassing you a little bit. And
oh, I love it. I love it.
But anyway, thank you so very much. Mike, you have anything left?
No, just want to say, Dre, let's not let this be like that's the only time we talk. You know, we also spoke about me coming down and speaking to your kids, if you want, man. Just hearing it from a different point of view, hearing it from a different voice can sometimes make all the difference in the world, man. And if I can touch one person, I can help you in any way, man, just feel free, man. I'll come a running, man.
Man, that sounds good. Well, I tell you guys right now that man, I absolutely love you both. I have been thrilled and enjoyed my time here. This is I love you know, just enjoying ourselves, just talking about, you know, things that perhaps could help people, but then, you know, just to laugh and get tickled about, you know, situations. I when Mike called and I was like, Michael Wilson. It's like, and
that's what,
like,
William Bedford said also.
Yeah, like Michael Wilson, you know, I was like, and then, you know, he shot me a text, you know, cause you know, Mike is, you know, he, you know,
I'm a little persistent.
He was a little big time saying, you know, he's a little big time saying he got out, you know, DC on me and I didn't get a chance to see my brother, you know, for a while. And so when he called and was talking about, man, he appreciate me answering the calls, like, man, stop, Mike. I said, I'd been something wrong with me if I don't answer this call, you know, right. With, you know, for, with my man. And then we talk about doing the podcast. I was like, that's what you mean, Mike? That's a no-brainer. Whatever you got going, man, I'm with you, you know. And I've tried to be like that with, you know, with all my brothers. You know, if they have stuff going on and want me to be, you know, involved, and let's get involved. And it's something that we could do to help somebody else. Let's do it. Let's see, you know, how we can make it happen. And, you know, I used to say these kind of things to guys a long time ago when I looked up and we had a gym full of NBA guys and I was playing overseas. And I told them, guys, if we all got together, because you look up and Lorenzo Wright, Elliot Perry, right. Penny Hardaway, Todd Day, Vincent Askew, I mean, all of Sid Henderson, all of us were in the gym playing, you know, together. I think we were at Kirby at the time, but playing. And I told them, guys, just think how impactful we could be to get together, to host a big camp, all of us together. But,
yes.
You know, everybody wanted to kind of have, and I understood it, you know, everybody came from different places and they right. wanted to kind of have, you know, the camps at their own schools. And I'd say, but if we got together and had a one big camp and then individuals want to have their camps and all of us showed up at right. each other's camp, it would be so impactful throughout the city. But you know, life happens and you keep on pushing and you do, you know,
that's right.
you know what you do. And, I am so blessed for you guys today to have me on here. And when y'all ready to do it again, hey, Mike, I'm just that phone call away, man. Sandy,
I know, man. I know we got to get the misses on here, man. We got to get the misses
sure, Sandy,
on here.
Make sure you have my information as well, Sandy. You have the email and stuff, but Mike, make sure you share my cell with Sandy. And if there's something that, you know, you want to reach out to me about, Sandy, by all means.
Well, I do. And so I'm going to stop the recording now. Thank you for being on the show today.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
You are so welcome.
Thanks, Dre.
Thank you for joining us on this episode of the Fifth Quarter Podcast with our guest, Coach Andre Turner. You can find Coach Turner and the Lane College men's basketball program on social media on Instagram at lanecollegmbb. If you love this show and our guests, you can support us by following the show on Apple and Spotify or subscribing to our YouTube channel. All the links will be in our show notes, and you can find them on our website at fifthquarterpodcast.com, and that's 5thquarterpodcast.com. Until next time, have a great rest of the week.